Bucko is glad to be here. I hope that you're just as happy about being in the house of God today. We serve a wonderful Savior. He is worthy of our praise and honor and glory. And so let's do this morning. Would you stand with me? And we're going to sing about the Lion and the Lamb, the wonderful Savior, the King of Kings, who has come to give his life on the cross of Calvary for you and me. And I'm so thankful I get to serve him as my God today. And all of God's people said, amen. Amen. Let's sing together.
He's coming on the clouds, kings and kingdoms will bow down. And every chain will break as broken hearts declare his praise. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. Every knee will bow before him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before him. So open up the gates, make way before the King of Kings. Our God who comes to save is here to set the captives free. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. Every knee will bow. Sins of the world, his blood breaks the chains. Every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before him. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord?
Recognize this morning that one day every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that you are Lord. And today we want to thank you. We want to praise you for the many things that you've done. Lord, every person here today has been blessed because of you, has been blessed because of your Son who you sent to die on a cross for us so that we could have a means of salvation, Lord, if we believe. And today, if there be someone here who does not know who you are, that today will be the day that they will recognize for the first time that they'll call upon you as their Savior and their Lord. Lord, if there's someone here today who has known you for a long time, but their spiritual life has begun to drift, Lord, may today be the day of restoration. Lord, bring us back to yourself. Revive us again. We pray for that today in Jesus' name. Amen. Go and remain standing. Let's continue to sing, Worthy is the Lamb.
Thank you for the cross, Lord. Thank you for the price you paid. Bearing all my sin and shame, in love you came and gave amazing grace. Thank you for this love, Lord. Thank you for the nail-pierced hands. Wash me in seated on the throne. We crown you now with many crowns. You reign victorious, high and lifted up. Jesus, Son of God, the treasure of heaven crucified, worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb.
Thank you for the cross, Lord.
Amen.
Thank you for the price you made, bearing all my sin and shame. Treasure of heaven crucified, worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb, seated on the throne. We crown you now. Let every breath
seated.
Amen. You're singing so well this morning. Let's do that again. A cappella. Ready? Here we go. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art. Lift it up. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art. Amen. Great singing this morning. Thank you for lifting up your voices to your Savior. He's worthy of our honor and our praise. He is great this morning, and I hope that you know that and believe that. Thank you so much for encouraging my heart. I love worshiping the Lord with you. You guys are such a blessing. Prayed for you this week, asking God to encourage your heart, to use you in big and mighty, marvelous ways, and I hope that He has this week. Hey, really quick, let's go ahead and dismiss all of our kiddos this morning. So we're going to start out by doing it this way. All of our kindergartners, you get to go first. 3, 4, 5-year-olds, all the kindergartners, you can slip out first, and you can go have a wonderful time in class and learn the Word of God and do some fun activities. So I hope that you will enjoy that. So all of our 3, 4, and 5-year-olds. Now, the big kids, all the big kids that are left, 5th grade and below, 4th grade below, you are welcome to slide on out with the goods today and go have some fun and learn the Word of God. When these kids leave here, they don't go just and play games. They're not just gone to watch VeggieTales, okay? They are gone to be taught the Word of God, to memorize Scripture, to learn God's Word and to apply it to their lives in a way that is more helpful to them. The guy that we have preaching for us this morning is way too intellectual to communicate to children, and I'm just kidding, he's not. 26 years in youth work, and now is traveling for almost the last 4 years in full-time evangelism, going across the country preaching God's Word. And if you were with us, how many of you were here last Sunday? You were in church last Sunday. Raise your hands nice and high. Everybody's here last Sunday. Warren, why weren't you not here? I'm just kidding. And couldn't resist. No, I'm just picking. Warren's here all the time. And how many of you you came to one of the nights of revival this week? Raise your hand if you're here for revival. Some of you. Okay, that is great. So last week, Pastor, we're preaching about, or I keep referring to you as Pastor, and I get it. And last Sunday, we were defining revival, and the opening thought for that was remembering as a child my mother having a Rainbow Vac salesman come in and do a demonstration, and how shocked she was to find so much dirt in her carpet, right? And that was it's kind of what led us into the book of James and getting our hearts and minds ready for what God would give you for us. And so we're really encouraged by that. Well, believe it or not, this is crazy. Tuesday morning, Carrie Vaca is just having just this crazy day and just needing to kind of, you know, get some encouragement from the Lord. She's had this running around morning all morning long, and then she gets back home. She's settling in the house, right, Carrie? And a knock comes at the door, and she opens her door. Can you believe who is standing at her door? A Rainbow Vac salesman. My mind was like blown. I'm like, I did not hire him. I did not send him by your house, Carrie. There's a lot of dirt in your carpet, but I didn't send him. And I'm just kidding. And I thought that was so funny. And there is a Rainbow Vac sales guy here. He's located downtown. There's a little office right there. You can go check it all out. But I thought, how cool would it have been to actually ask the Rainbow Vac man to go by all of your houses just for a little extra plug and, just a reminder. It's revival time. It's the time where we come and hear the Word of God and let God expose some things. It's kind of like standing in front of a mirror and letting God show us what's going on and then encouraging us to take care of it. And so I hope that you'll do that today. Whether you know Jesus Christ or not, We're just honored that you'd be here to come and study the Word of God with us. And so if you haven't heard the introduction, Kirk Copeland is an evangelist. He travels the country, different churches every single week, sometimes multiple churches in a week, and he preaches the Word of God and encourages others. And he has been a blessing to us. He has truly come in and let us know that it doesn't matter how difficult the time that we live, there's a God that we can keep our hearts and minds focused on. And so I want him to be a blessing to you today. He's going to come and preach to you. And looking forward to seeing what God has for us this morning.
Thank you, Pastor. And what a joy to be at New Life Baptist Church. Thank you for the honor. What a blessing. And I thank God for your pastor's friendship. And he's been so kind to me and undeserving. By the way, thank you for being in church today. And I know it takes extra effort. Some of you are in here for take two. How many of y'all are duplicates? You were here first time and now back again, and they pay y'all double for that, right? You're going to get double pay this week for being in church twice, or half off your tithes. Maybe that's what it is. I'm just kidding. Some of you are like, that's what I get? But no, I'm just kidding. I am so glad to be here. My name is Kirk Copeland. My wife and I travel together in evangelism, and my wife is not able to be with me. She was supposed to be here. We were preaching in Michigan up until Thursday night this past week, and we had tickets to fly here to be here this weekend with y'all, and my wife got sick, and she was pretty bad sick, and so we changed her flight, paid extra money, sent her home, and she is at home right now, maybe watching online right now with us, and so she'll critique me later on the message that she wrote for me, and I'm just kidding, but we have a great time serving the Lord together. We've been married almost 30 years. And 29 years, today is October the 14th. So we've been married 29 years, 10 months, and 13 days. And time zone messes me up. Somewhere around 20 hours. And I'm really that romantic. I really am. And actually, we got married on January 1st, so it's real easy to do the math if you start putting it together. But we have a great time serving the Lord together. God's given us two daughters. We love our daughters. They're both older and out of the house. If you were here this week, you heard me tell you that my youngest is married. My oldest is still single and ready to mingle. And so I'm going to find her a husband somewhere across my travels, and I'm going to match her up. I'm taking applications. So if you know someone, you let me know. We'll get her married off. Let someone else start paying her bills. That's what it is. And anyway, I'm so glad to be here, and we're going to go to Acts chapter 16 this morning, and I remember as a young man surrendering to preach, and the first message I preached as a teenager, I gave an illustration of the first service that was after I was a youth pastor, but as a teenager, the first message I got to preach was this passage of Scripture. It's extra special to me, and I did it for a competition, as a matter of fact, in our Christian school, and ended up winning that competition and going on. It was not this message, but it was from this passage. I love this passage of Scripture. I remember the first message I preached, though, or going out, I surrendered to preach one man in our church came to me and said, I want to take you to the Nashville Rescue Mission and preach at the Nashville Rescue Mission. And I was blown away by the opportunity, but the girl I liked, her family went too. Hopefully my wife's not listening right now because that wasn't her that I liked at the time. But anyway, I was dating this girl, and her dad was going to the National Rescue Mission and did that often, and she would go often. So I was a sucker. I'll go. Yeah, let me go because I got a chance to be around that girl a little bit more, and I wanted that. Well, this particular week, this man asked me to go and preach. Well, I studied. I prayed. I mean, I studied and studied and studied and prayed. I got ready. I went through commentaries. I got with my youth pastor. I got this message ready, and I was ready to get up and preach. And I preached the entire message and finished the message, and I wanted to recap it, you know, to go back over and review what we had talked about. And I went back through the message really literally a second time, start to finish. And I closed my Bible, and I prayed, and I walked off the platform, and I'd been there for a total of 5 minutes. Some of y'all are praying, I hope that's the way it is today. And it won't be, but I've learned how to take it longer now. But I spent 5 minutes on that message. That was a mess. It really was. I was embarrassed about that. I love to preach. I love to share God's word. I love to smile. I love to encourage God's people. I'm not here to beat you down. I'm here to encourage you today. I want you to see Jesus this morning. I want you to know that Jesus loves you and he knows your circumstances of life. He knows everything you're facing and he loves you and he's got great plans for you. Look at Acts chapter 16. I want you to see this passage of scripture here this morning. Acts chapter number 16, beginning in verse number 22. Let me give you some context even before we read it. The apostle Paul, he and Silas are preaching together here in this passage of scripture. If you've been in church at any time in your life or you studied some about the life of the apostle Paul, he wasn't really a really good guy. Paul was a wicked man. I say wicked. He hated Christianity. Paul, in his life, he made it his purpose to go into churches like we're gathered at today, who are worshiping Jesus as the Savior. And he would break through the back doors of those churches and he would arrest and persecute and punish. He would literally, in some cases, persecute to the point of death people who believed in Jesus. Paul wasn't a man who loved Christianity. Paul hated the church. And it was his mission in his life to tear down the church, to beat the church in the name of his own religion. But God saw fit to meet Paul on the road to Damascus. Paul, one day going to Damascus to persecute the church in Damascus, God met him on the way. We call it his conversion on the road to Damascus. And Paul met Jesus as his personal Savior on the road to Damascus. God struck him off his horse. God spoke to him. And that day, Paul was gloriously saved. He met Jesus Christ as his personal Savior, and his life was changed. No longer did he hate the church. Now he became a preacher of the truth of the gospel. His life changed. No longer the way he used to be. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. Paul's life was truly changed. And now Paul's preaching the gospel. The people he used to persecute, now Paul is going out and telling them how to live for Jesus. And God changed his life. This passage of scripture in Acts chapter 16, Paul is literally standing with one of his preacher friends, Silas, and they are proclaiming Jesus. And as they proclaim Jesus, the magistrates, the religious leaders of the false church there in Jerusalem hated Paul now. They sought to kill Paul. They wanted to destroy Paul. They didn't like Paul in any way whatsoever. And here Paul is preaching the glorious gospel of Jesus. And that's where we pick up the reading. He's preaching the gospel. We get to chapter 16, verse number 22, and the Bible says this: "And the multitude rose up together against them," against Paul, against Silas. "And the magistrates," the religious leaders, "rent off their clothes and commanded to beat them. When they had laid many stripes upon them, they cast them into prison, charging the jailer to keep them safely, who, having received such a charge, thrust them into the inner prison and made their feet fast in the stocks." The Bible says, verse 25, "And at midnight," after they've been beaten, after they've received that persecution, they're bleeding, and they're laying in their stocks, handcuffed to the walls in that old Mamertine prison. The Bible says that at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed, sang praises to God. The Bible says, and the prisoners heard them. I say parenthetically as I start this message, how do you react when things don't go your way? When you have a hard time come your way, when people persecute you. Here, Paul, humanly speaking, had not broken any laws. Paul had not done anything wrong. He'd not robbed the bank. He'd not murdered someone. He had not stolen from his neighbor. He had not committed any crime. But yet now Paul, the preacher, has been attacked and been thrown in jail. He's been beaten. They ripped off his clothes. They took that whip and they brought that whip across his flesh back, ripping the flesh off of his back. He had not done wrong. You gotta understand, Paul didn't deserve what he was facing. You ever felt sometimes life isn't fair? I know, maybe you haven't, but I have. I've got three older brothers. Life is certainly unfair many times to a younger sibling. My brothers would torture me. They'd beat me for no reason. I never deserved it. They'd torture me. One of my brothers, Kelly, he's got a girl's name, he'd sit on my stomach. He'd hold my hands over my head. He'd put his face right up against my face, and he'd say something like this. He'd say, "Who's your daddy?" I'd look at him and say, "That's dumb. You're an idiot. My dad is your dad. You're stupid. I knew you were dumb." And my brother would slide his fat body up further on my stomach, put his knees on my guns, on my BBs. He'd pin my arms to the ground. I know some of you men, you're thinking, "No, my brother never, I beat my brother." I tried. I tried everything in my power. I would kick, I would scream, I'd yell. Sometimes I'd spit. That's not smart to do when you're on the bottom like that. Man, I had war with my, "No, get out of it." And then he would take his middle finger of his right hand and he'd just knock right on my sternum. Just that, he didn't punch. He wasn't hitting me, just a simple little knock right on that sternum bone. And I'd sit there and I'd look at my brother and I'd say, "Doesn't hurt. Doesn't hurt. Kelly has a belly full of smelly jelly. Doesn't hurt. You're a sissy. I hate you. It doesn't hurt." About 45 seconds into him just knocking right there on that sternum, I'm like, "Ah, get off me. It hurts. I'm crying. Mom, help." Man, it hurts so bad. And then he would slide back off my stomach. He'd put his hands back on my wrists over my head. He'd put his face this far from my face. And he would say, "Who's your daddy?" You would think I was smart enough to know what he was doing, but I wasn't. I'm crying, "Roger Copeland." He'd say, "No, I'm your daddy." And he'd slide back up. He'd do the whole thing over again until I would get to the point where I'd say, "Okay, you're my daddy." That's weird. That just doesn't even make sense. You know what he was trying to tell me? "I'm in charge of you. I'm your boss." You ever said life isn't fair? Well, I was saying it then. Who made him boss? Who made him ruler over me? And then sometimes I would get in trouble for things he did. It's just not fair. And here's Paul. His crime was preaching Jesus. His crime was telling people, "Jesus loves you. Jesus died on that cross for you." That was his crime. And they took Paul. They took Silas. They beat him. They took their clothes off, whipped him with the whip, threw him in this solitary confinement, the inner prison. Put their feet fast in handcuffs, in stocks, chained to the wall. Talk about life not being fair. His crime was preaching Jesus. I love Paul's response. You know what my response is? "It's not fair. Why is this happening to me? God, why don't you judge that person? God, how could this happen in my life?" But here's Paul and Silas' response. Verse number 25, well, look at verse 24. "Who receiving such a charge that he should keep them safely, thrust them into the inner prison, made their feet fast in the stocks." Verse 25. "And at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed, sang praises." Can I ask you, New Life Baptist Church, is that your response when life doesn't go the way you want it to go? Or are you like me? "It's not fair. It's just not fair." That's me. That's my normal response. Or as I told you earlier in the week, my other normal response is I'm going to punch them in the throat. I don't deserve that kind of treatment. God, how could you let this happen in my life? God, this isn't fair. But not Paul and Silas. Paul and Silas, the Bible says, they prayed and sang praises. God, you know what you're doing. God, I trust you. I learned from their response. Number one, in my notes, I wrote this down. Here's what Paul and Silas said. They acknowledged that God is always in control. Do you know that God knows exactly what he's doing in your life? God knows your address. God knows the problems that are there. God knows the job you work. God knows the people you work with. You know that coworker that just jumps on your last nerve? I know. They're there. God put them there. Why? Because God's going to use them to help grow you, help grow me. We had a girl in our youth ministry. I didn't say this in the first service. We had a girl in our youth ministry. That do you ever see that spiritual documentary, Monsters, Inc.? There's a character in that movie. Her name is Roz. She has the most annoying voice in the world. She has a line in there that she's probably most famous for. It's this. It's, Michael Wazowski, I'm watching you. Can I tell you, we had a girl in our youth ministry. I believe she was the voiceover for Roz. I'm telling you, the most annoying voice you'll ever. She would walk in the back door of our youth room. We had a large youth ministry. She'd walk in the back door, and she walk. Literally, we could be in the middle of doing something. She'd walk in, and she. This was her. Brother Kurt, I'm here. And I'm like, oh my. Oh my. And not only was she annoying in her voice, she didn't believe in that personal bubble. You know, we all have a personal bubble. We all are comfortable with someone being in a certain distance away from us. By the way, all of us have a different distance on that personal bubble. You know, some of you, you're okay being closer to someone. Some of you, you know, COVID, 6 foot apart, you're like, praise God. Finally, they're not in my face. This girl, she didn't believe in that. She didn't know what a personal bubble was. And she'd walk in and she was like, poof! I mean, like right up in my face. And she's like, ha, 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 Brother Kurt, ha, 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 I'm so glad to be here. I'm like, and I'd back up. I'm just politely like, yeah, hey, it's good to see you. Yeah, thank you. And every time I'm backing up, she's just walking with me. Finally, I'm up against the wall and I'm like, ah, even so, Lord Jesus, come quickly. Rapture happen right now, please. It was awkward. It was like, you ever had someone, your workplace get on your nerves? You ever had a neighbor get on your nerves? You know, you mow your yard, you blow the clippings. Wait, we're in Arizona. Never mind. You walk the dog and the dog goes, their dog goes to the bathroom in your rocks. What? What's up with that? Use your own rocks. Don't let that happen. And that neighbor gets on your nerves. That coworker gets on your nerves. Or, God forbid, that spouse gets on your nerves. Or that child gets on your nerves. Hey, how do you respond when things don't go the way you want them to go? When life isn't the way you like it, what's your response like? Here, Paul and Silas, when things didn't go the way they wanted them to go, they're literally laying in this muck and mire of an old Mamertine prison. Shackled to the wall. Blood dripping off of them. Why? Because they were telling people about Jesus. They didn't deserve that. How do you respond when things don't go well in your life? Hey, could I challenge you? Number one, acknowledge God is in control. God knows what he's doing in your life. There's nothing that comes your way that God hasn't already put a check mark by it and said, it's okay. I'm going to let this happen in their life. I went to Thailand in 2010, preaching a revival in Thailand. It was my third out of four trips going to Thailand to preach. And on that third trip, I stayed in the same place I'd been in the previous 2 years. I was at the same ministry. I did all the same things that I'd done before. I went to bed that night. Our missionary that we were working with, he was from our church, and he was an old Marine. I mean, gruff, about 5'6", little short guy, 4x4, you know, 4 foot wide, 4 foot tall. He was gruff, mean, and snakes would come up to bite him. They'd look at him, they'd turn around and run. That was the kind of guy he was. And Brother Horn, he's in heaven now, so I can say whatever I want about him. Brother Horn was that missionary, and he put me in that room, same room I'd been in before, and I went to bed that night and went to sleep. I guess I was kind of in a fetal position, my hands next to my face. That night, I got bit. I guess he put spiders in my bed. I don't know. But I got bit right under my wedding ring, halfway up my middle finger, all the way up towards the tip of my pointer finger, and then right under my right eye, right where my hand was at. I got up that next morning, walked down there. He got up and had devotions with the people there of his church like at 4:30 in the morning. Oh, can I just tell you, God's awake at 9 in the morning too, just so you know. But he got up at 4:30. We got down there. I'm sorry, I probably shouldn't have said that. But he is. I got up there for devotions and walked down there. I'm scratching my hand. I said, Brother Horn, I said, you put me in the bed with spiders in the bed. What were you thinking? He said, Copeland, shut your mouth. Quit complaining. These kids here are going to see, they're going to think that's normal. All you Americans just gripe and complain. I said, I was just kidding, Brother Horn. I was just teasing. But you got spiders in my bed. You man up, you sissy. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. 10 days later, I came home and was bad sick. Went to the doctor, the nurse practitioner, as a matter of fact, diagnosed me. Said, have you been out of the country? I said, yes, sir. Went to Thailand. He said, did you get bit by anything while you were in Thailand? I said, yeah, as a matter of fact, first night I was there, sleeping in bed. Missionary put me in the bed with spiders. Got bit by spiders in the middle of the night. He said, are you sure they were spiders? I said, I was asleep. I don't know. He did all sorts of blood work on me. I didn't leave yet. He's running tests. I don't know how he did it. He came back and he said, I believe you have malaria. I said, malaria? That's the disease that kills people, right? He said, yep. I said, great. Great. He put me on this real intensive dose of quinine, some really mean poison medicine they give you. I took that. I tell you, it drove me crazy. I lost my hearing. My vision was blurred. He said, you're going to have side effects. They gave me a list of side effects, and I had that many side effects plus some extras. It was crazy. I got off that medicine finally, started going back to church. And I got back to church and come to find out there's different strains of malaria. They treated me for one strain, and it wasn't that strain. And I got to feeling better, got off the medicine, and I got bad sick. Passed out at church. Ambulance came, picked me up, took me to the local hospital. They transferred me from there to Nashville, to Vanderbilt University Medical Center, one of the best hospitals in the world. I got there to that hospital. I don't remember any of it. They told my wife in the ambulance, this is the words they told my wife, prepare yourself. This is not good. Your husband's organs have already started shutting down. Chances are he's not going to make it. My wife's crying. I don't remember any of it. Obviously, I'm here. By the way, don't worry. You can't get it from me unless I shake your hand. Otherwise, you're perfectly fine. So, I'm just kidding. You can't get it that way either. I didn't ask for malaria. But it's just not fair. Hey, can I tell you, I still don't know why I faced that. It's still in my system. I don't know why it's there. I don't know why I deal with that. Can I tell you this? God knows what. This jailer came to a place where he acknowledged, God, you're in control. God, you know what's best in my life. God, you know what you are doing. God, I yield control to you. God, thank you for knowing what you're doing. He acknowledged his need. Excuse me. He acknowledged, God, you know what you're doing in my life, and I need you. The Bible says this. By the way, he acknowledged his need and the fact that he said, what must I do to be saved? Do you know what I know is true about every one of us here in this auditorium today? We're all sinners. Aren't you glad you came to church for that one today? I went to church today. This guest speaker insulted me. Well, let me just take you off the equation. Let me tell you me. I'm a sinner. The Bible says this in Romans 3:10, there is none righteous, no, not one. Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Isaiah chapter 53, verse 6, all we like sheep have gone astray, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. We're all sinners. Isaiah 64, verse 6, all of our righteousness is as filthy rags. You know what that means? The best person at New Life Baptist Church here this morning, the most godly person here, the best one, if we had to rate who's number one and who's, I'd be at the bottom end, just so you know. But if we had to rate who's where in this good versus bad in this church, it'd be a lady for sure, because you ladies are a whole lot more spiritual than we men. We're knuckleheads. Amen. But you know what God says? The best person in this room is at best a sinner. Here this jailer had to come to the point where he said, God, you're in control. You know what you're doing. And God, I can't do it on my own. I have a need. I can't meet it on my own. He looked at Paul. He looked at Silas. The Bible says he pulled out his sword and would have killed himself, seeing that the prisoners were fled. They weren't there. He knew his life was coming to an end. And in his desperate moment of not knowing, what do I do? He sees Paul and Silas. They answered in the next verse. He says to them, what must I do to be saved? Verse number 30. Let me get there to the Bible. Verse number 30. Let me find my spot. And the prisoner, excuse me, go back if you would. I told you verse 30. Go back just a little bit there. Verse 26. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaken, and immediately the doors were open, and everyone's bands were loosed. And the keeper of the prison, waking out of his sleep, seeing the prison doors open, he drew out his sword and would have killed himself, supposing the prisoners had been fled. But Paul cried with a loud voice, saying, do thyself no harm, for we are all here. Then he called for a light and sprang in and came trembling and fell down before Paul and Silas and brought them out and said, here's his question. He acknowledged his need. He acknowledged God's in control. God's doing what he's supposed to do. I need God. I need God. And he said, sirs, what must I do to be saved? Here this prison guard ready to take his own life, nothing to live for. If those prisoners had fled and they were gone, this man was going to be tortured and put to death. And rather than going through that, he pulled his sword and was getting ready to kill himself. And Paul said, no, wait, we're here. And this man, this prison guard, came out to Paul and Silas and said, sirs, what must I do? He saw his need. Hey, folks, we all have that same need. Every one of us, we're sinners. I can't get to Jesus on my own. Neither can you. The Bible says in John 14:6, the Bible says, Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. That's what Jesus says. It's not the church that saves you. It's not your religion that saves you. It's not giving money in an offering that saves you. It's not getting dunked in a baptistry that saves you. The Bible says this, for by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It's the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. I live in Middle Tennessee. We from time to time witness to people there in that area and knock on their doors and tell them about Jesus. You know what I hear a lot from those good old Southern hospitality Tennesseans? Here's what I hear. Well, I'm a pretty good person. I think when I die, my good works will outweigh my bad works. You know, that big scale in heaven, as long as my good deeds are greater than my bad deeds, then God will let me into heaven. Can I tell you, that's not true. That's not what the Bible teaches. Oh, we would rationalize that, humanly speaking, but the Bible says it's not by our works, but according to his mercy, he saved us. I can't earn heaven. I can't get there on my own. I can't be good enough. I can't be kind enough. I can't love people enough. I can't do those good things in my life to earn a place in heaven. The only way I get to heaven is through the precious blood of Jesus Christ. When Jesus stretched his arms out on the cross of Calvary, look at me, folks. He was thinking of you and me. When he died on the cross, he put your sins, he put my sins on him, on his own body. He paid my sin debt. And he paid your sin debt. This jailer had to come to a point where he said, you know what? I can't do it on my own. I can't get to heaven on my own. God, I need you. He said, sirs, what must I do to be saved? I see number two in verse number 31. That jailer had to understand that he had to place his faith in Jesus alone. Look at verse number 31. The Bible says, and they, Paul and Silas, said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. By the way, could I just remind you here? It doesn't say, go do penance. I don't know. Don't go. It doesn't say, go get baptized. I'm a Baptist. I believe in baptism, but not for salvation. The Bible's very clear about that. That water doesn't save me. Now, I get saved by putting my trust in Jesus Christ. That's how I know I'm going to heaven. It doesn't say, be nice, help old ladies across the street, and you get to go to heaven. It doesn't say that. It says, believe on Jesus, and thou shalt be saved. The Bible says in Romans 6:23, to call upon 10:13, excuse me, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. I don't get to heaven by being at New Life Baptist Church. I go to heaven by putting my faith and trust in Jesus Christ. By the way, thank God for New Life Baptist Church that teaches you the truth about how to know you're going to heaven. Thank God for that. But the church can't save you. Religion can't save you. This man had to understand his need. His need was Jesus, and he had to understand, I have to place my faith, I have to place my trust in Jesus Christ. Believe means to put your confidence or your trust in. He had to say, I can't get to heaven on my own. I need Jesus. I need a substitute. I need the Bible uses the term propitiation, big word. What does that mean? A substitute, an atoning grace. My daughters, I didn't say this in the first service, my daughters, when they were little, my oldest daughter, Angel, she is a chocoholic person. She goes to the ice cream shop, and they have one of these ice creams called Death by Chocolate, and she orders that every time. I mean, she'll get something like that, and then she'll get chocolate syrup and put it on top. Then she'll put chocolate chips on top. I'm like, ugh. I'm okay with chocolate, Snickers bars, yes. But that's about my limit. I'm not a real big chocolatey kind of guy. My daughter loves it. When she was little, she'd go into the kitchen in the pantry, and she'd open the pantry, and she'd reach in. My wife is as organized as anybody I've ever met in my life. She'll go grocery shopping, and then she brings it back. She takes the stuff out of the packaging from the grocery shop at the grocery store, and she puts it in these clear Tupperware containers. And you know, like chocolate morsels, you know, you make chocolate chips with, she'll open the bag, she'll pour it into this clear container, put the lid on it to seal it, and then she labels it. You can see in it to see what's in it, but she still labels it. I don't understand. That's how OCD she is. And she's got and they all stack in there just right, and the cat, it's so organized. I love to just go in there and rearrange things just to be mean. That's just my personality. I enjoy that kind of stuff. And my daughter, you know, seven years old about this time, she walked in there and she reached up and she grabbed that chocolate morsel container. She pulled it out. She ran to her bedroom and she got on her bed and she just opened that container. She just started eating these chocolate morsels. She ate the entire container. Well, not the entire container. That'd be kind of weird. She ate what was in the container. And she, when she finished, she closed the container and she stuffed it beside her bed against the wall. And she left it there. A few days later, I was walking by her bedroom, and she was making her bed. And from time to time, I just enjoy going in to help. I said, Angel, can I come in and help you make the bed? She said, oh, yeah, Dad. And for me, when I make a bed, I want to, every corner is tucked. I mean, I'm going to make it, you know, bounce a dime or a quarter off of it. That's, I'm making it right. And so I pulled her bed away from the wall. When I did, I heard, clunk. I looked back there. And there was that Tupperware container empty. And I thought, that good-for-nothing little girl, you wicked sinner. But then I thought, you know what? I'm not going to confront her yet. I'm going to wait. I'm going to see if she'll confess. And so I finished making the bed, pushed the bed back against the wall, left the container there. I went back to the kitchen, walked straight to the pantry, opened the pantry door, and I hollered out, hey, Christy, my wife's name, hey, babe, where's the chocolate more? I was loud. I wanted everybody in the house to hear. My daughter's 7, 8 years old. I wanted everybody in the house to hear. Hey, babe, where's the chocolate morsels? My wife, honey, they're in the pantry. No, honey, I can't find them. By the way, we as men, we can't find things. My wife started getting, honey, they're right in, they're labeled chocolate chips. Honey, I'm looking everywhere. They're not, they're right in front. No, they're not here. My wife's coming around. I'm like, shh, stop, stop. They're not here. Gabby, my second daughter. Gabby, have you seen the chocolate morsels? She's 5. No, Daddy. I'm not. Gabby, are you sure you haven't touched the chocolate morsels? I'm doing drama here. I'm having a big old time. Gabby hollers out, no, Daddy. Dad, probably Angel. You know she eats the chocolate morsels. So I say, Angel, have you seen the chocolate morsels? That good-for-nothing little sinner. She said, no, Daddy, I've not seen the chocolate morsels. And I'm like, oh. See, we have a rule in our house that if you do wrong, you're going to pay the consequences of doing wrong. We practiced biblical discipline, just a simple spanking. But if she did wrong, she stole the chocolate morsels, she deserves a spanking. If you lie to cover it up, 2 for the price of 1, she's getting a double spanking. And so I'm thinking, I don't want to give her 2 spankings. So I'm like baiting her a little bit more. Angel, are you sure you haven't seen the chocolate morsels? No, Daddy, I haven't seen them. Angel, we all know you love chocolate morsels. Are you sure you didn't get those chocolate chips and eat those? Angel, make sure you tell the truth. No, Daddy, I didn't take those. I'm like, ugh. I walked into her bedroom and I grabbed the end of the bed and pulled the bed out from away from the wall. And as soon as I started pulling the bed out, my daughter's like, Dad, I'm so sorry. I'm sorry, I know, I shouldn't. I picked up that container. I said, Angel, you knew you did that. You know you're not supposed to do it, and you did it. And you lied. I said, Angel, I'm so disappointed in you. I said, you know you deserve a spanking.
Yes, sir, I know.
You know you deserve 2 spankings. Because you lied.
Yes, sir. I know. I'm sorry, Daddy. I'm sorry.
I closed the door and I got the paddle. She laid over the bed. She got her first spanking. She's crying. You ever had one of those cries you couldn't talk? You know, that's what she was doing. And she said, Daddy, can I just wait for the second spanking, please? I said, yes, we'll wait, we'll give it some time.
Daddy, do I have to have the second spanking? Daddy, I'm so sorry.
I said, no, Angel, you lied. You deserve the second spanking.
Oh, Daddy, please.
About that time, there was a little knock at the door. I'm not making this up. I knew it wasn't my wife because the knock was way low on the door and it was a very soft knock. And I said, Gabrielle? your sister and I are busy in here. Gabrielle, I don't know. I know you parents, you dads, you've never gotten frustrated like this. I was like, Gabrielle, I told you we're busy in here. Gabrielle. And I reached over and I grabbed that door handle and I yanked that door open. Gabrielle, we're... And I looked down and my little five-year-old daughter was crying. And I said, Gabby, what's wrong? She said, Daddy, I know Angel did wrong. She took the chocolate chips. She deserves a spanking for that. She's crying, Daddy, and I know she lied. She deserves a second spanking. She said, Daddy, would it be okay with you if I took Angel's second spanking for her? I stood there. I'm fighting back tears. But I'm thinking in my mind, I didn't say any of this out loud, but I'm thinking in my mind, whose child are you? What idiot takes their siblings spanking? No one in their right mind. I was cheering when my brothers got a spanking. My daughter looks at me and says, Daddy, can I take her second spanking? I'm like, no, you're dumb. I need to send you to a specialist. That's not normal. I didn't know what to do. Pastor McCormick, they don't teach you in college and in parenting 101, how to deal with something. I don't remember parenting 101. I don't remember parenting anything. I looked at my daughter. My wife came around the corner. She's crying. My little daughter, Gabby, she's crying. I'm crying. My daughter, Angel, just got a spanking. She's still crying. I didn't know what to do. I looked at my wife. She didn't give me any help. I looked at Gabby. I looked at Angel. I said, Angel, Angel, I said, you heard what your sister just said. You want to take your sister? Do you want your sister to take your second spanking? She's crying. Big old smile now on her. Yes. Yes. Thank you, Jesus. Yes. Like, you wicked sinner. I don't know if this is right or wrong. Condemn me, I guess. I don't know if I did right. I don't. I told Angel, you stand right here. Gabrielle, 5 years old, leaned her over the bed. My daughter standing right there next to her, the one who deserved the spanking. You say, Brother Kurt, were you nicer to Gabby than you would have to Angel? I wish I could tell you yes, but I wasn't. I gave her the same spanking that her sister was supposed to get. I gave her those swats and she stood up, she's crying. And my little five-year-old daughter, she got the spanking her sister was supposed to get. And as soon as she stood up, she ran to me and wrapped her arms around me. Said, Daddy, I love you. Daddy, I love you. My wife came over. She threw her arms around us. We're all snotting and crying. Angel's still over there like, thank you, Jesus. She came over crying. You know what my five-year-old daughter taught me that day? The lesson that Jesus teaches us when he stretched out his arms on the cross of Calvary for you and for me. Jesus took my place. I deserve hell. I'm a sinner. I deserve the wrath of God. But Jesus looked at God the Father and said, Father, I'll take Kurt's punishment. I'll take his place on my own body. I'll pay his sin debt
And I stood back and watched my Savior stretch out his arms on the cross of Calvary and die in my place. That's the substitute. See, this prison guard came to the point where he said, I can't get to heaven on my own. I must trust another, the substitute, Jesus. And that day he was gloriously saved. Hold on. There's a last part of that verse. I'm almost done. Look, if you would, please, at the end of verse number 31. The Bible says this, and they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. And the last three words, do you see it? And thy house. By the way, you can't vicariously help someone else get saved. You can't get saved and spread it to someone else. They have to choose for themselves. Every person has to choose salvation for themselves. So just because dad, jailer, got saved doesn't mean his house automatically was saved. They had to trust you. So how? Look down at verse number 33. The Bible says, and he took them the same hour of the night and washed their stripes and was baptized, he and all his entire family. They all got saved that night. How is it that this man who got saved then walks home and his family gets saved? How does that happen? Because there was a man whose life was gloriously changed and he couldn't keep it to himself. He had to tell his family. He had to go home and say, hey, honey, I got saved. I'm on my way to heaven. How about you? Hey, kids, you on your way to heaven? Hey, grandma, grandpa, aunt, uncle, cousin, nephew, niece, hey, do you know you're saved? This man went home and his whole family was changed because he acknowledged his need, knew he had to place his trust in Christ, and then he shared it with his family. I'm done. Can I give you an illustration? I'll stop. I got saved when I was 10 years old. Little old small church in Mattoon, Illinois. I was sitting on the center aisle. We had a center aisle in our church, and I was 10 years old. The pastor preached that Wednesday night. I couldn't tell you the first thing he preached. I'll be honest with you. The only thing that was going through my mind as I listened to him preach that night was this. If I die today, I'm going to go to hell. I knew I was a sinner. I knew God's wrath. I knew God hated my sin, and my sin had to be punished. I knew that. And as a 10-year-old boy, I was literally stricken with the fear of dying and going to hell. The pastor preached that Wednesday night, and he stepped down where I'm standing now, off the stage. And he said this. He said, I'm going to give an invitation tonight. I'm going to invite you to respond to the preaching, how God's spoken to your heart. We all love invitations to a birthday party or something like that as kids growing up. God gives us an invitation. His invitation is, come unto me, all you that labor and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. God loves you. Our preacher stepped down from the pulpit and he stood where I'm standing now and he said this. He said, I don't know why I'm giving an invitation tonight, but I believe God wants me to. And it was like the Holy Spirit of God smacked me in the back of the head. You know how mama does sometimes in church, teenagers? It's like the Holy Spirit did it to me. Said, Copeland, this is for you. Trust God today. As a little 10-year-old boy, I didn't want to die and go to hell. And he gave that invitation. I stepped out of my seat and I walked forward. I stuck my hand out to my pastor, Pastor Amstutz. He looked at me and said, Kurt, what'd you come forward for? My answer was this. I don't want to die and go to hell. Some would say, well, that's not a good reason to get saved. I've been preaching for a little while. I asked your pastor this in the first service. Have you ever heard of a bad reason to get saved? I got saved because I didn't want to die and go to hell, period. And on January the 11th, 1982, as a 10-year-old boy, I got saved.
I ask Jesus Christ to be my, I put my trust in Jesus. Not in my church, not in my religion, not in my works, not in anything I could do, but I put my trust in Jesus. Can I ask you, whether you're a guest here today or whether you've been here for 8+ years, can I ask you, are you going to heaven? If your life ended today, well, I've got the rest of my life to live. I'll get saved later. And by the way, that's a very true statement. You have the rest of your life to live. The problem with that statement is we don't know how long the rest of our life is. My life could end today. I don't want it to, but it could. Well, God's going to decide where I go. No, 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 no. God says, whosoever shall call upon me shall be saved. Are you saved? John 3:16, for God so loved New Life Baptist Church. Let's make it personal. For God so loved Kirk Copeland that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him, that if Kirk Copeland believes in him, he should not perish but have everlasting life. Put your name in the verse. Make it personal. Do you know you're going to heaven? Do you know you're going to heaven? This jailer on that evening, somewhere around 12:15 in the morning, trusted Jesus Christ as his personal Savior. Have you done that? But that jailer didn't stop there. He went to tell his family. I got saved when I was 10. I remember after I got saved, I went home and got on the phone and I called my grandma's. Call my Grandma Hackney. Grandma Hackney, I got saved. Oh, Blondie, that's so good. I'm proud. That's wonderful. Call my Grandma Copeland, my blind grandma, if you were here in the week, the one I rearranged the furniture on. I called her, and I called my Grandma Copeland, said, Grandma, I got saved. She said, you sure needed it. About time. I've been praying for you. Called my uncles, called my aunts, called my cousins. I couldn't wait to tell. I'm going to heaven. I'm saved. I'm on my way. I was so excited. I called my Uncle Larry. I said, Uncle Larry, I got saved. I'm on my way to heaven. My Uncle Larry said, oh, that's good, Kurt. Happy for you. I said, Uncle Larry, you're going to heaven, aren't you? My Uncle Larry paused for a minute and he said this. He said, I'm fine, Kurt. I was 10 years old. I was like, what do you mean I'm fine? I don't understand that. He said, I'm fine. I just let it go. Surrendered to God's will when I was 15. Called my Uncle Larry again. Uncle Larry, I'm going to live for God. I don't know what he wants me to do, but I'm going to live for my Uncle Larry, when I was 15, sold me my first car. It was a 1971 Ford Torino. It was a muscle car. It was Easter egg green. It was ugly as ugly can be, but it rumbled nice. It was, you hit that gas pedal and the whole car would move, you know, that torque in the engine and the gas gauge every time you hit the gas pedal. I mean, it was like, I'm glad I don't have it now with the price of gas now. Man, I wouldn't have any money. And the truth is I called him when I was 15 and said, Uncle Larry, told God I'm going to do whatever he wants me to do. I said, Uncle Larry, you know you're saved, right? My Uncle Larry's, Kurt, I told you before, I'm fine. Leave me alone. 16, I surrendered to preach. The Bill Rice Ranch, Ron Riley preaching. Surrendered to preach, and I called my Uncle Larry. Uncle Larry, you're going to have a nephew who's a preacher. He's like, oh, great. Uncle Larry, you know you're going to heaven, right? Kurt, I told you before, leave me alone. Went to college, wrote him a letter. Told him in the letter, I love you, Uncle Larry. I want to see you in heaven someday. Trust Christ. Please trust Christ. Went to visit him, family reunion right after that letter, and I'm 20 years old. Walk up to my Uncle Larry, you get my letter? And his countenance changed. He looked at me, cussed at me. I told you, leave me alone. I don't want anything. Don't ever talk to me about that again. I did still a couple more times witness to him. 2018, my mom called me. This is her brother. My mom called me and said, Kurt, Uncle Larry's gotten a bad report from the doctor. He's got terminal lung cancer. They'd already removed a quarter of his left lung. Now he's got cancer in the other lung. They said it's inoperable. There's nothing we can do. I finished preaching a revival for a camp for a group of teens in Missouri, and I went back to my church. I asked my pastor, Brother Norris, I said, can I take some vacation days, two vacation days, drive up to Illinois, about an eight-hour drive, to go talk to my Uncle Larry? He's going to die. I don't want him to die and go to hell. Drove up to Illinois, and I pulled in front of his house, 2202 State Street, right in front of the green grass. I didn't tell him I was coming. I called him on the cell phone. I don't even know why I'm doing that. It's like this. Called him on the cell phone. Said, Uncle Larry, it's Kurt. He's like, hey, Kurt, how are you? I said, I'm doing good, Uncle Larry. I just wanted to know if we could talk for a few minutes. Well, sure, we can talk. I said, Uncle Larry, I'm sitting out front of your house. He said, what? He said, I was wondering who was out there. I was getting ready to call the police. I said, don't call the police. It's me. I walked into his house, and I sat down on his couch. He sat on the recliner. He had those oxygen tubes running all throughout the house, had it strapped to his face. Sat down on the couch. He's on the recliner. His wife, Kim, sitting right next to me, and I sat there together with my uncle and my aunt. I said, Uncle Larry, Jesus loves you. He wants you in heaven. My Uncle Larry went through, he asked me a million questions. Well, if God's so good, why does he let this happen? Or why is this preacher, why did he mess up like that? How can God be okay with? He just kept asking all sorts of questions. And I sat there that day with tears in my eyes, said, Uncle Larry, I can't explain why all those bad things. Sin is sin. God judges sin. And I don't know why those preachers mess up. That's terrible. I hate that. It's sin. It's not. God's not happy with that. But I want you to know, Uncle Larry, God loves you. 2.5 hours into it, my Uncle Larry looks at me and says, Kurt, would you just shut up and tell me how to be saved? So, Uncle Larry, you're the one asking me the questions. Halfway through it, I reached out and grabbed that oxygen tube. I pinched it shut and I said, turn now, trust Christ now, or you're going to die. I'm just kidding. I didn't do that. I wanted to. My Uncle Larry bowed his head and trusted Jesus Christ as his Savior. My Aunt Kim bowed her head and asked Jesus to save her. Both of them that day, after 36 plus years of me saying, Uncle Larry, please. He finally bowed his head and prayed. Just 3, 4, or 5 months later, my phone rang. My mom called and said, Kurt, she's crying. Uncle Larry's passed away. I cried, but I'll be honest with you, I was rejoicing. Why was I rejoicing? Because he was no longer suffering in the pain, and now he's seen Jesus face to face. He's kicking up gold dust in heaven. He's running those streets of gold, fishing in that crystal. I don't know if that's allowed or not, but if it's allowed, he's doing it. Fishing in that crystal river. I'm telling you, he's having the time of his life. He's in heaven today. And I stood in front of our family and friends that day at his funeral as I preached my uncle's funeral, as his body laid in state just beside me. Then I said, Uncle Larry's not in the casket. Uncle Larry's in heaven. He's not here. He's there. Why? Because he put his faith, he put his trust in Christ. And I said to my family and my uncle's friends, how about you? And there were hands that went up in that service who said, I'm going to trust Christ as my Savior. Hey, folks, can I ask you today? Who's your Uncle Larry? Who is it in your life that if you don't tell them about Jesus, they might very well spend eternity in a place called hell? You say, well, that's not my response. Oh, no, no. Our responsibility as a Christian is to share Christ. God commanded us to. Now, that doesn't mean you look at him and say, turn or burn, you wicked sinner. Matter of fact, all that does is push people away. But who is it in your family you can say, hey, I want you in heaven. I love you. Who is it in your life? Who's your Uncle Larry? By the way, it may be a coworker. Maybe a neighbor. Maybe an old high school friend. Who's your Uncle Larry? The invitation, the invite for you today is real simple. Number one, do you know you're saved? If your life ended today, are you going to heaven? You can know that. 1 John 5:13, these things are written unto you that believe on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, that ye may know that ye have eternal life. Jesus wants you to know you're going to heaven. Jesus loves you. If you're here today and you're not sure you're going to heaven, trust Christ today. Don't wait. Don't wait. Well, I'll do it some other day. We don't know when our last day is going to be. Don't wait. Trust him today. But if you're a Christian here today, who's your Uncle Larry? Who are you telling about Christ? Every head bowed, every eye closed, we're going to pray. We'll give an invitation. I want to give you a chance to respond to God's word today. Can I just ask you today, can I ask you just a couple personal questions? By the way, that's why I had you bow your head and close your eyes, because I don't want you not to respond because you're worried about what someone else might think or who's looking at you. So just to keep it anonymous and private, that's why we have you bow your head and close your eyes. Can I just ask you two simple questions? Number one, how many today would say this, Brother Kurt, I'm not perfect, but there's been a time in my life I put my trust in Jesus Christ, and if my life ended today, if my life ended right now, I know I'm going to heaven. I'm not perfect, but I'm a Christian. I'm born again. I'm a child of God. I am a saved person. I'm not perfect. I've not arrived, but I know I've put my trust in Christ. I'm a Christian. If that's you and you know you're saved, you know you're on your way to heaven, would you just slip up your hand with no one looking? Would you slip up your hand as a testimony of the fact, I'm a Christian. I've got it settled. I'm on my way to heaven. God bless you. A multitude of hands. A sea of hands. Praise the Lord for that. God bless you. Thank you. You can put them down. Thank you. That's wonderful. I anticipated that. That's wonderful. But not every hand did go up. Can I ask this question? And I would never in a million years ever embarrass anyone with this. I won't point you out. I won't call your name. I will not approach you. I will not in any way embarrass you. But as a friend, I would love the honor of just praying for you. I won't embarrass you. Please understand I won't. But I'd love to pray for you. In general, I won't embarrass you in any way. But if you're here today and you'd say, Brother Kurt, the truth is, I'm not sure I'm on my way to heaven, but I know this, I know for sure I don't want to die and go to that place called hell. I'm not sure I'm on my way to heaven, but I know for sure I don't want to die and go to hell. Brother Kurt, would you just pray for me as we close the service? Would you just remember me in prayer as you close the service? I'm not sure I'm going to heaven, but I know for sure I don't want to die and go to hell. If that's you and you would be willing to let me pray for you, just simply pray for you, would you just slip up a hand? I won't embarrass you, but I'd love to pray for you. I'm not sure if I died today, I'd go to heaven. But I know for sure I don't want to die and go to hell. If that's you and you, let me pray for you. No one's looking. I'd just love to pray for you. If that's you, just slip up a hand. I'd love to pray for you. Amen. Amen. God bless you. God bless you. Thank you. You can put them down. Hey, if you raised your hand, could I just challenge you in just a moment? I'm going to pray for you. But when the piano plays in just a moment, the music plays, would you just step out of your seat and come and shake Pastor's hand? He'll be right down here in the front. And he'll know what you're doing. And he or someone will take a Bible and show you from the Word of God what it means to be a Christian. Would you step out and let us help you with that today? Would you trust Christ just like this jailer did? Would you trust Christ today? Those are my two questions. Could I do this before I pray? Would you all just look at me one more time, and I'll pray, and we'll give the invitation. Just look right here at me. Can I ask you one more time? Who's your Uncle Larry? Who's that person that God brought to your mind that if they took their last breath today, They may not go to heaven. They might very well spend eternity in a place called hell. I know that's not a fun thought. But could I challenge you today to pray for them by name? I'm not telling you to pray out loud so everyone around you can hear you. I'm telling you, would you care enough about their eternal soul that you would pray for God to save them? Will you care for them like that? I would invite you to care to come to pray at the altar. You can pray in your seat. I understand. But Christian, maybe you coming to the altar might encourage the ones that raise their hand, not sure they're on their way to heaven, to come out too. Christian, would you pray? Would you name that person to Christ? And then it may just be that God would lay it on your heart this afternoon to write him a little letter. I'm talking old school. I'm talking about buying a stamp. Mortgaging your house enough to buy a stamp. They're so stinking expensive. And send them an old-fashioned letter that says, I love you. I want you in heaven. Trust Christ. Maybe they're close enough you could drive to them and talk to them. I'm wanting you, number one, to pray for them, but number two, act on the prayer. Let's care enough to do something to see them saved. I'm going to pray. After I pray, the music will play, and we'll all stand to our feet when that happens. And as the music plays, would you, Christian, just find a spot to kneel and pray? Would you pray for that person God placed on your heart? And if you're here today and you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior, today, trust him. Today, don't put it off. Don't wait. Lord, I thank you for your love. God, I thank you for your goodness. Thank you for salvation, God. Thank you that you sent your only son to die on the cross of Calvary for me. God, I don't deserve that, but I'm so thankful for it. I'm thankful for the story of this jailer here with Paul and Silas, who he trusted you as a Savior. He saw his need. He knew he had an issue. And God, you saved his soul when he put his trust in you. And Lord, there were some that raised their hand here this morning in this service that asked me to pray for them. And I promised them that I would pray for them. Lord, I don't know them. I don't know their situation. It's none of my business. But I promised them as a friend that I'd pray for them. So Lord, right now, I pray that you'd give them the courage to step out, to come talk to Pastor Ray, and get this matter of salvation taken care of today. Help them to leave church today with that victory of knowing I'm on my way to heaven, and that could happen today. God, give them the courage, please. And Lord, I pray for Christians today. I pray for our lost loved ones. I pray for our family, for our friends, for our coworkers, for our neighbors. God, help us to care enough to make a difference in their lives for you. Thank you, Lord, for your love. Bless this invitation time in a mighty way. In Jesus' name I pray. With every head bowed and every eye closed, let's all stand to our feet. The music is playing. Some are coming to the altar. How about you? You raised your hand and said, Brother Kurt, please pray for me. I'm not sure I'm saved. Would you let us talk to you today? Would you let us talk to you? Hey, would you pray for that family member? Would you pray for your Uncle Larry today? Would you call out their name to Jesus today? Do you care enough to pray for them? Do you care enough to tell them? Let's let God use our life in a special way in sharing the love of Christ with others. As we continue in a spirit of prayer, hey, Christians right there in your seat, would you call out to God? God's working. God knows what he's doing. You say, well, the hour's late. Yes, I did go overtime. I'm sorry about that. But can I tell you, God's working. Maybe God's stalling it just a little bit for you right there in your seat to make a decision for Christ. Maybe God's waiting on you right there to call out that family member, that friend. Call out to God for them right now. Mention their name to Jesus as the music plays. You pray. You pray. You pray. knows what he's doing. He knows your circumstances in life, and he loves you. Let's share Jesus. Let's share Jesus.
Father, thank you so much for your precious word. Lord, examples of the gospel, the work of Christ upon Calvary in the hearts and lives of people. Lord, it doesn't get any clearer than this jailer, the story of Paul and Silas. And Father, we thank you for the finished work of Calvary, the pulling, the drawing of the Holy Spirit so that this man could know you as his Savior, he and his family. And Lord, now I pray that you'd help us to learn this lesson from your word and then send us forth to make a difference with the gospel message, Lord. We have a responsibility. We need your power and your work. Lord, I feel you're drawing people, encouraging people, and I pray that you would do that. Lord, we love you so much. Thank you for what you're doing here. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Before you're dismissed, let me just share a couple of announcements with you. And first of all, thank you so much for being here, for preaching the Word of God, and opening up your own life, exposing some of those things so that we can know how to relate to the gospel. And we just thank you so much. Do me a favor. Would you go ahead and slide out? And I'd love for people to get a chance to shake your hand and get to know you. And so I appreciate you doing that. Just a couple quick announcements, and I'm going to dismiss you. Ready? First of all, Recharge Youth Conference is this Saturday, all right? Now, listen, please, I was a little aggressive this morning, and I want to be that with you as well. The Recharge Youth Conference is for two different people. It's for our teenagers, and it's for moms and dads. And so it's a time for you to come in and hear preaching and teaching that'll help you in the stage of life you're in right now. You can be seated if you want to just for a second, but it's a great conference. Mom and dads, please, I am encouraging you that what our teenagers are facing is unlike anything any of us have ever faced before. And we all need to be equipped to do this. And so we have put together on purpose a conference so that you can come and learn how to navigate, to how to be encouraged, to be strengthened in these areas as well. And so I hope that both of you will decide to be a part of this. Teenagers coming out, moms and dads as well, get registered ASAP in the app. And as a matter of fact, moms and dads, you don't know what an example you will be to your kiddo, saying, hey, y'all, we don't know everything, and we really want to learn so we can help you be the best version of you that God wants you to be. And so I encourage you to come out and be a part of that. But get registered in the app ASAP. Our Pinterest party is coming up on November the 3rd. This is for our ladies. Now, this is one of the biggest outreaches of our year. It's an opportunity for you to bring a lady, a friend, someone you know, to an event that she would just thoroughly enjoy, but at the same time, get to hear the gospel. Would you please plan on being a part of our Pinterest party? It's always the first Friday night of November, and looking forward to this wonderful opportunity. Melody's working really hard to get everything prepared for you, and an opportunity for you to invite and invest in somebody's life. Great meal, great time of craft and fellowship, and then encouragement in the gospel. So I hope that you'll invite a lady to come out. And as a matter of fact, there is a cost for this event. It always is. Nothing great ever comes without a sacrifice. But we always encourage our ladies to pay for your guest ticket. And if you can't, we'll be glad to help with that. We just want your guest here. And so let's work together to be a part of our Pinterest party, ladies, on November the 3rd. Christmas celebration right around the corner. If you want to sing in the choir for the Christmas celebration, sign up in the app or see Tyler. He'll be glad to help you with that. Now, two quick, really neat notes. First of all, the Awaken Cafe, that is our coffee shop here on campus. All the proceeds that come into the Awaken Cafe go to a ministry. And for the first several months, we gave it to Tim Avila, who we introduced to you several weeks ago. We are now doing something local. The Lachlan family, who owns and runs the Good Ruby bookstore, has recently had a little boy, and that little boy is under extreme pressure, just special needs. And the financial difficulty of something like that is just astronomical. We want to be a help as a church to the Lachlan family. And so just want you to know, every coffee that's bought in the Awaken Cafe will not go, seriously, think about this. This is a heavy thing to say. It will not go to an organization that supports wrong living, sexual behavior, and even terrorism. It will go toward somebody who needs help and the love of God in their life. And I encourage you to take this opportunity to give toward this family, to be a blessing to this family, and to love others through the gospel of Jesus Christ. And then lastly, we did decide to take on Tim Avila as our next missionary. And so we're super excited about that. We'll be supporting Tim for $200 a month, and he'll be on our group of missionaries that we're going to be a blessing to across the country and across the world, matter of fact, there in the Philippines. And so we're just super excited to announce that to you. All right? I hope that you've had a blessed day. If you have any questions about anything, we're here to help you. Please pray for me this week as I'll be preaching a revival in Palm Springs starting tonight through Wednesday, and want to be a blessing to the people that are there and need prayer for safety. I'm going to be jetting out like immediately. It's about a 4.5-hour drive, and I start at 6:30. And so pray for our safety as me and the boys take off, and I'm looking forward to having a great time there. All right? God bless you. Have a great week. You are dismissed.